Good morning. Happy, joyous Easter morning. However you've joined us this morning, we're so glad that you're able to join the Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth celebration of Holy Eucharist for this Easter Sunday morning. I hope that you're able to be with us in any way that you can. And today we start our celebration of Holy Eucharist with our opening acclamation. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that we who celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection may be raised from the death of sin by your life-giving Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. A reading from the Acts of the Apostle. Peter began to speak to Cornelius and the other Gentiles. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did in both Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now, if everyone will join me in reciting Psalm 118. Give thanks to the Lord. for he is good. His mercy endures forever. Let Israel now proclaim, his mercy endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. There is a sound of exultation and victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord has triumphed. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord has triumphed. I shall not die but live and declare the works of the Lord.
The Lord
has punished me sorely, but he did not hand me over to death. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter them. I will offer thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. He who is righteous may enter. I will give thanks to you, for you answered me and have become my salvation. The same stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes.
On this day the Lord has acted. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Colossians. Since you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth, for you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of each heart be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. This morning, along with the psalmist, we sing, "On this day the Lord has acted. We will rejoice and be glad in it." On this day the Lord has acted. Early this morning, while dark, Mary Magdalene comes to the tomb and sees that the stone has been removed. She runs to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, presumably John, and suspecting the worst, she says, "They have taken the Lord." Suspecting the worst, she believes they have stolen the Lord's body. So the two disciples run to the tomb, and as Mary warned them, it is empty. Just the linen wrappings remain. Now, an empty tomb is not evidence by itself of anything miraculous or good. And the disciples are not expecting anything good. They have no false hopes. No one wonders aloud, "Do you think it's possible he is risen?" No one recalls from faint memory and says, "Didn't Jesus once say something about rising in 3 days?" The disciples look in the tomb and return home dejected and disoriented, while Mary stands outside the tomb weeping. At first glance, it puzzles me that the two disciples could leave her there in such distress. But that magnifies how self-absorbed everyone is in their own grief and their guilt and their hopelessness. They are unable to offer comfort. They don't have the inner resources, the inner wherewithal to offer help. Spiritually, they are bone dry. They can't do it. So Mary is left at the tomb in her grief. Then, as John tells the story, she bends over to look into the tomb, perhaps one last time, and she sees two angels to whom she cries, "They have taken away my Lord." And then she turns around and Jesus is standing there. Mary fails to recognize him, supposing him to be the gardener who moved the body, until Jesus calls her by name. He says, "Mary." Christ is risen. Christ is risen, and in that moment, Mary is raised with him. Mary moves from total despair to unfathomable joy. Mary is raised to new life. On this day, the Lord has acted. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Today, it's all good news. I frequently tell a story about an experience I had in seminary which opened my eyes to the meaning of the good news. Good news being, by definition, the definition of the word gospel. In seminary, everyone takes an in-depth class in preaching. Each week, we would prepare a sermon, a homily, to be preached in our class, to be preached to our class and our professor and the camera. This was before we were televangelists. Well, one day, when one of my classmates preached, he captured our attention with a good story. He proceeded to meet us where we were in terms of what we called the human situation. The human situation can be our brokenness, our sin, our grief, our limitations, our confusion, our hopelessness at times, our pain. As our professor said, he always was saying this, he said, "Seminarians are really good at locating and expressing the human situation." And on this occasion, the student was on target. Our classmate nailed the human situation, the problem. And then he shifted gears to suggest what we, the people called by God, the body of Christ, the church, what we ought to do about it. End of sermon. In the name of the Holy Trinity, amen. Well, we all sat there and waited for the professor's comments. There was a long silence. We knew the delivery of the sermon was effective. The preacher hooked us with a good story. He met us where we were, so it was relevant. He challenged us to do something in the name of Christ. And finally, from the back of the room, with his booming voice sounding to us like General George Patton, Professor Hilmer Krause bellowed, "Where is the good news? Where is the good news? You've just told me what's wrong in the world and what I ought to do about it. That's not good news. What I ought to do about something is not good news," he said. "The good news is what God has done and what God is doing and what God has promised." Now, without a doubt, the church is called to respond to the good news. To someone who's traveling through the valley of the dry bones or through a dark night of the soul, we may be to them the good news in the flesh. We may actually embody the good news to someone who is barely hanging by a thread. But the professor's point is taken. The good news is what God has done and what God is doing. On this day, the Lord has acted. Christ is risen, and we are raised with him. So on this Easter day, we celebrate God's action in the resurrection. Three things about the resurrection. I'm sure there are more than three, but being Trinitarian, I'll suggest three for now. First, the resurrection tells us something about God. The resurrection means that God can create something new. God can open up a new possibility. God never meets a dead end. No human situation, no human being is beyond the power of God to resurrect, to raise to new life. God can create new life anywhere. Second, the resurrection happens not only to Jesus, but to us as well. Christ is raised to new life, and we are raised with him. When Jesus calls Mary by name and she encounters the risen Lord, we can bet that she experienced new life in that moment. She moved from the total despair of the walking dead to new life. We are raised with Jesus. And not only in this life, in the here and now, but in the life to come as well. During the Eucharistic prayer at funerals, the presider stands at the altar and prays the following. The presider says, "For to your faithful people, O Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when our mortal body lies in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens." Life is changed at death, not ended. And third, the resurrection has the power to set us free from fear. The late Peter Gomes, the longtime Harvard chaplain, he says, freedom from fear is the achievement of the resurrection. It is not death that lurks in the background. It is the fear of death. And to diminish those fears is to gain everlasting life. For the disciples, life began when they stopped being afraid. The resurrection has the power to change a life controlled or directed by fear and insecurity to a new life of freedom and courage, all because we can trust God. The resurrection tells us we can trust God. Fear not. It's all good news today. Nothing can stop Easter. Mary goes to the tomb in a state of despair and hopelessness and disorientation and grief. Then Jesus calls her by name, Mary. And in an instant, she is raised to new life, born again. Christ is risen, and Mary is raised with him. And so are we. For on this day, the Lord has acted. And so we make our Easter acclamation. Alleluia. Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Let us now profess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Almighty God, we pray for your holy Catholic Church,
that we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you,
that your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, the presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church, Scott, our bishop, and for all bishops, priests, deacons, and lay leaders.
that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world, especially Donald, our president, Greg, our governor, and Betsy, our mayor.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
For those
in command of the military and all who serve, and their families at home.
That your works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. We pray for first responders, nurses, doctors, all medical professionals and hospital staff, for their skills and for their safety during this COVID-19 pandemic. And we ask your blessing on those we now name. We pray to you, O Lord,
that they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
And also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may love and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you. Peace of Christ.
Peace of Christ.
Peace.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Oh,
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death. And by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son and his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood, send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you what is pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.